I want to say that this is going to be a little different than our previous webinars. We are doing, as you can see, Dr. Blevins is going to be talking directly to you instead of doing a slideshow presentation. You can still type in your questions during the webinar. There's a little box on the side of your control panel that allow you to do that. We'll gather all the questions for the end. And Dr. Blevins is joining us from University of California, San Francisco. His main clinical interests are in the evaluation and management of patients with various disorders of the pituitary gland and hypothalamus. He has particular expertise with regards to Cushing syndrome and has edited a book on the subject. He also has extensive experience in treating patients with acromegaly, prolactinomas, and other pituitary tumors, diabetes insipidus, and hypopituitarism. He has extensive experience in the management of patients with growth hormone deficiency. Dr. Blevins is medical director of the California Center for Pituitary Disorders at UCSF. His current research interests involve diagnostic testing in patients with hypercortisolism. He is currently evaluating new ways to test for presence of Cushing syndrome. He is also interested in clinical predictors of surgical and medical success with regard to the management of patients with different types of pituitary tumors. Some of his work involves collaboration with neuropathologists at UCSF. Dr. Blevins is also involved with industry-sponsored trials to evaluate new pharmacological therapies for patients with pituitary tumors. And on that note, Dr. Blevins, I'll turn it over to you.
All right, thank you, and thanks to all of you for joining us, to the Pituitary Network Association for sponsoring this presentation by providing the ability to do this. They don't pay me anything. This is totally volunteer on my part. It's part of my contribution as being a member as well. And we'll focus today on the hormonal issues after surgery in patients with pituitary disorders, and also on the long-term treatment and some of the long-term side effects of medications. I'll talk for a bit. I've already received some questions by email. I'll talk for a bit on some of these topics and my approach, and then perhaps we can start taking questions sooner rather than later. I wanted to do this webcam format rather than showing you a bunch of slides, so we could maybe make this interactive and sort of do this real as I would with patients in the exam room rather than showing you a bunch of slides and using those as a crutch to talk. So the first thing I'll say is that you all know that the pituitary gland, we call the master gland. It controls other glands in the body, and those glands we refer to as target glands, even though they're important or more than a target, but the pituitary does indeed control those. And it's very important for our homeostasis and survival that the pituitary and its target glands work well and work normally, and if they're not doing so, that we as physicians and patients work together to get the hormones just right. And what the first thing I'll say about that is just right for one person is not just right for another. And it's important to keep in mind and teach your physicians that a normal range for pituitary hormone doesn't necessarily mean it's normal for you as a patient or for me as a physician, for example. And what I mean by that is, let's use IGF-1 as an example. We know that IGF-1 is a protein made by the liver in response to growth hormone. And IGF-1 we consider to be an integrated marker of growth hormone secretion. We know that IGF-1 levels change with age, so the normal range has to be different for age. And we also know that every individual person has their own little normal range, their own little bell-shaped curve. And let's say, for example, a healthy middle-aged person, maybe the normal range is between 75 and, say, 275 or maybe even 300. And the mean would be in the middle of that, and the normal distribution would encompass 95% of the population to come up with that lower part of the normal range and the upper part of the normal range. And your normal IGF-1 might be 250. And if you have pituitary disease and your IGF-1 is 100, that could be too low for you. And a lot of physicians would say, well, the result is normal. You don't need any attention to this. On the other hand, you might be at 100 is normal for you, but you might be at 250 and actually have acromegaly. So the concept of what a normal range is and what's normal for the individual is important to understand with all of these particular hormones. Another classic example where that applies is in the thyroid hormone. So the free T4 can go from 0.6 to 1.8 in some assays. And if you're at 0.7, a physician might say you're normal, but you may be feeling tired and fatigued and gaining weight and needing more sleep. and needing more thyroid hormone if you have pituitary disease, to where maybe a level of 1.2 or 1.4 would be normal for you as a patient. So those are some of the concepts we as physicians try to apply, at least some of us physicians try to apply in the management of our patients, to where we try to think about optimizing medical replacement therapy and interpreting hormone levels to begin with to decide if medical replacement therapy is necessary. And my own approach is that if a patient's going to go to the trouble of taking a hormone, whether it be thyroid hormone or whether it be growth hormone or even a drug for acromegaly to lower their IGF-1 levels, if you're going to go to the trouble to take those drugs, I'm going to go to the trouble to optimize therapy, ensure that the dose is just right. And with that in mind, as endocrinologists, we often do play Goldilocks. You know, if something is too low, we want to make it just right. If it's too high, we want to make it just right. Sort of this approach of regressing to the mean. As Goldilocks didn't like it too hard or too soft, it had to be just right, or too hot or too cold, it had to be just lukewarm. So that's pituitary endocrinology in a nutshell. With that said, when it comes to treating patients with pituitary disorders, we aim to have normal pituitary function, whether we're lowering a hormone to normal or raising a hormone to the normal range, and not only normal range, but what's normal for that particular person. And sometimes we have to do both. We might have a patient with acromegaly who needs treatment to lower the IGF-1, but also has hypopituitarism and needs replacement therapy to bring all the other hormone levels to the normal range. So it becomes rather difficult for the endocrinologist sometimes to chase a lot of hormones round and around to get them just right for the patient, but that's our job. That's what we do for a living. The other thing that I will mention before we get started talking about some of the specifics is that endocrinologists are a rare breed, and sometimes we believe things that we believe for different reasons. Some endocrinologists believe in totally natural replacement hormone therapies, if you will, and others believe in traditional, tried and true FDA-approved therapies, and I'm one of those who believes in the tried and true scientific basis. I like to apply the art of medicine using the science of medicine and the evidence-based medical approach. So I tend to subscribe to traditional therapies and not a lot of the panaceas or, if you will, some of the natural replacements that a lot of folks will tout. And we'll talk more about that in a little bit. But there's a lot of pseudoscience out there on the internet, and there are a lot of things that aren't really well studied and proved and approved by the FDA, and I caution you to get involved in some of those things in your quest to try to get healthy and to do the very best that you can, because if you study some of those topics in detail, you'll find that you're really treading in muddy waters with regards to hormone replacement. And I think it's best to do things that are most likely to definitely work and have been well studied. So when it comes to the pituitary disease, the first thing that I think about is, are the hormones working normally? And in patients who don't have normal hormone replacement, they may require thyroid hormone, for example. And thyroid hormone should be replaced according to standard guidelines. And in patients with pituitary disease, we often have to look at the free T4 level to decide if the dose is correct. And sometimes the free T3 level. The big warning for you as patients there is, I have seen time and time again physicians looking at the TSH as a marker of whether the thyroid hormone dose is correct. That's perfectly fine for patients who have primary thyroid disease, but it does not work for pituitary disease. So as a pituitary patient, your doctor needs to be checking your T4 and your T3 levels to make treatment decisions. It's okay to check the TSH, but the treatment decisions depend on the T4 and the T3. One of the biggest problems is, I see people who have a low TSH or an undetectable TSH, and they're on thyroid hormone, and their physician lowers the dose of thyroid medication. And then they go back 6 weeks later for more blood tests, and the dose of thyroid medicine is lowered further because the TSH is still unmeasurable. And the physician's not recognizing that the TSH is unmeasurable because the patient has pituitary disease. So keep that in mind. Your T4 and your T3 are your targets. Most patients require T4 only because the kidneys and the liver convert the T4 to T3, but some people have defects in conversion and require T3 therapy as well, and that's probably about 10% of my patients. It's unusual to require T3 also. but usually T4 is the replacement drug of choice. Some patients take animal preparations of thyroid hormone. That's okay in some people, especially if you're allergic to the dyes that are in the thyroid hormone preparations, but it's not really optimal because you get a mixture of T4 and T3 in the animal preparations, and the T3 levels can sometimes be too high when you're taking a fixed animal preparation like Armour Thyroid or Proloid or one of those other preparations. We use them in some of our patients, but it's not my favorite choice of therapy because of the potential for T3 toxicosis. And you might say, well, what's the problem there? We know too much T3 causes osteoporosis and can stiffen the heart and impair cardiac responses to exercise and lead to more trouble than it's worth in the long run. So again, regardless of whatever hormone you take, you want your T4 and your T3 levels normal for you, and that's the goal with the replacement therapies. In regards to long-term complications of thyroid hormone, if the levels are normal, there are no complications, but if the levels are high, you can have problems with the osteoporosis, stiffening of the heart, poor responses to exercise, and actual heart attacks can be precipitated as well. So it's important to make sure that's just right. In regards to pituitary gonadal function, it's very complex. Men usually require testosterone. My favorite brand is the testosterone gels. I think they're absorbed better and you get levels that are more mimicking the normal male sort of rhythm of testosterone production, if you will. And the problem with the injections is that if they're given every 2 weeks, men usually have a period of time where the injections are too high and a period of time where they're too low. That's not as much of a problem as in the aging male, but younger men tend to notice those swings in testosterone, and it leads to mood disturbances and irritability, et cetera, when the levels are low. So the testosterone gels or topical testosterones, and there are plenty of those, tend to lead to better stable levels that mimic the normal daily variation in testosterone production. And I prefer the gels to the injections, but we use the injections in some people. I'm not a fan of the oral testosterone preparations, and I've not yet used the pellets, though I understand that urologists often do that. We're not equipped in our center to inject pellets and under the skin. I have had a couple of people who come to me having used them through urologists, and the problem with those patients is they have high testosterone levels, levels that I'm concerned about with regards to their cholesterol being altered in an adverse way, and also the prostate gland enlarging with treatment. The hormone replacement in women is a little bit more complex. It depends on the age and the stage in life and the goals of therapy, for example. Most women who are of reproductive age, it's okay to use a birth control pill, which has both an estrogen and a progestin. As a woman gets older, however, she should switch to estrogens and progestins. And then the decision about whether to have a period monthly is sort of between the patient and her physician. Some women feel more comfortable if they are having a period every month because it seems normal to them. And we can do regimens that can cause you to have a menstrual period every month or to not, or to have a menstrual period every 3 months, just depending on the preferences. Women without a uterus, it's best to just get estrogen only. The older a lady gets, the lower the dose of estrogen we find usually is successful. Hormone replacement in women is only FDA approved to treat symptoms of menopause for that. So whenever we see a patient with pituitary disease, we're actually using estrogens off-label, but we recognize as endocrinologists that they're very essential and critical to not only sexual function, but sense of well-being and probably also memory and brain function as well. And I'm a strong advocate of estrogen replacement unless a woman has a history of blood clots, breast cancer, or hypertriglyceridemia or some other contraindication to using them. Women who have pre-existing coronary artery disease probably should be very careful. Topical estrogens bypass the liver and are probably safer and lead to less risk of blood clotting and less risk of cholesterol or triglyceride abnormalities. So we like topical estrogens when we can get away with them. They're harder to use in younger women because of the dose doesn't seem to get as high. My target for treating a lady with estrogen who's postmenopausal is to have the estrogen level above 50. For younger women, sometimes 120 to 150 or even 200 seems to be adequate and appropriate, depending on the treatment that's being used. The Women's Health Initiative that came out in the 1990s sort of led a lot of physicians to believe that estrogens were more dangerous than they are of benefit. But I think a lot of those earlier results have been debunked, and we now believe that estrogens are appropriate when it's not any contraindications, such as pre-existing heart disease, for example, or breast cancer, or blood clotting disorder. So it's important to review those risks with the physician as you're deciding on treatment. I'm often asked about compounded therapies or natural estrogens or bioidentical hormones. I've actually done a lot of research in that area, and I have patients who are on those treatments, but I don't prescribe them. So I ask them to see physicians who are more commonly used to using those medications. But if you do the research, and I would advise you to look at bioidentical hormones on Wikipedia if you're doing bioidentical hormones, you'll see that they're not regulated. There's a lot of problems with the actual bioavailability of those hormones, and there are a lot of potential complications and errors in treatment. And I think that most would read the Wikipedia article and several other related articles and decide that it's a little bit sketchy and it's not a tried and true and proven method for taking female replacement hormones. I've seen patients who've been overtreated with estrogens, overtreated with testosterone, and have also had side effects of some steroids that have been put in those bioidentical hormone preparations. So I think it's important to educate yourself before you use a product like that and to find the physician who's skilled in the use of those treatments. And I tend not to prescribe those. It's just as, you know, some physicians don't do gallbladder surgery because they're vascular surgeons, and it's the physician's choice to not provide that aspect of medication. And I tend not to prescribe bioidentical hormones, just as I don't do medical marijuana prescriptions. So it's sort of just, you know, a physician's individual choice. So I'm a firm believer in this traditional tried and true estrogens and progestins for women. I think that some women do better if they take testosterone as well. And I have, even though that's not been shown to be fully effective, if I have patients who want to try a low dose of testosterone for libido, we can do that if the progesterones don't improve their libido. And that's probably more interesting or necessary in women who are hypopituitary than women, say, who are in menopause, because they also lose the androgens produced by the adrenal gland, which lower their libido and decrease muscle mass, for example. So that's a little bit off-label, but I'll consider that in some patients. And then I've often asked about DHEA supplements, and there's one study that suggests that DHEA might be useful for women who are hypopituitary with adrenal insufficiency and hypogonadism. That's the only study I'm aware of that suggests that it might be beneficial to patients. I have men who have taken it and have done well. I've had other men who take DHEA and grow breasts because the DHEA can be converted to estrogens. So it's sort of one of those sort of by choice over-the-counter preparations that some patients choose to take just to try to improve their quality of life. It's a little bit outside the realm of traditional replacement hormone therapy, but it's something that some of my patients do and find benefit in. And so long as their DHEA and DHEA sulfate and estrogen levels are not elevated, I'll usually say that it's fine to get those supplements and take them. When it comes to fertility treatments, we do a fair bit of that in our clinic as well. For women, we usually refer them to reproductive endocrinology, but for men, I usually take care of that, and we usually treat with HCG and, if necessary, FSH also. And I tell patients who have pituitary disease that, in contrast to when I was in my training in the early 1990s, late 1980s, many people with pituitary disease were essentially thought to be infertile and could not have children. Nowadays, I think fertility rates can be restored to normal rates for age, so that a 20 or 30-year-old, for example, maybe even a late 30-year-old, should have a fertility of about 75% with appropriate treatment. So this is a nice area to be living in for pituitary patients in that arena. Sometimes insurance company doesn't want to pay for fertility treatments, but usually we're able to sort of get that taken care of one way or another with insurance company by appeals. Steroid replacement for the patient who has pituitary adrenal insufficiency can be a rather arduous process. There are several different steroids that can be used. Some people respond to some drugs, other people don't respond to the same drugs. What we use in our practice, and it's an approach that I sort of started after talking with David Orth, who was my predecessor when I was at Vanderbilt, is that our favorite drug is dexamethasone, and we use a dose of anywhere from 0.125 to 0.375 milligram daily. And the average dose is probably 0.25 milligram daily, and I'd say probably 80% of our patients do fine on that particular dose. The dose of dexamethasone we use is not too much. I think the equivalent replacement dose is between 0.25 and 0.375 for a normal adult. 1/6 of patients are slow metabolizers and need a lower dose. Now, if you look at the old textbooks, they said a dose of 0.75 was a replacement dose, but some research I did at Vanderbilt proves that that's incorrect. That's really these much lower doses that we use. The nice thing about dexamethasone is it's a one-time-a-day dose, and the levels tend to stay up and last throughout the day, so that patients tend to feel better than they do with other hormone replacement therapies. Hydrocortisone is the drug that's equivalent to the steroid that the adrenal glands make, but the problem is the half-life is 81 minutes. So it's very short. So when you take a dose, it gets absorbed, and then it starts getting metabolized quickly, and it's gone, half of it's gone every 81-minute cycle. And many patients on hydrocortisone tend to feel weak and tired on doses, and they tend to escalate their doses, and before you know it, escalating the doses to try to feel better leads to them being on too much, and then they start getting side effects of being on too much. And we found that there's less of that sort of patient self-medication and a better sense of well-being using dexamethasone compared with hydrocortisone. I think that the dose of hydrocortisone that's equivalent to replacement is probably 20 milligrams a day, maybe 25 milligrams a day. Certainly 30 is probably too much. And sometimes taking 10 in the morning, 5 at lunch, and 5 at the evening meal is probably the best replacement if you're going to do hydrocortisone. But again, the half-life is short, and your levels are going to be low as they are in normal people at bedtime. But if you got the flu or had an injury or whatever, you wouldn't have steroid on board. And you have to sort of triple the dose pretty quickly for a severe illness or a medical procedure. Whereas dexamethasone patients, I think, tend to have less symptoms or signs of adrenal crisis or steroid deficiency when they get sick. So I use the dexamethasone for a lot of different reasons. Some patients take prednisone. That's what their physician has prescribed. It used to be thought that 7.5 milligrams of prednisone a day was replacement therapy, but we now know that about 3 to 4 milligrams of prednisone is the normal dose of steroid for a normal adult. So if you're on 5 milligrams or more, you're probably on too much and should review that with your physician and think about other replacement hormone strategies. The unfortunate thing about steroid replacements, we don't have a test to use to decide what dose is correct. So we used to have to base it on the, or usually have to base it on the symptoms and signs of the patient. Do they have any symptoms or physical signs of being on too much, or any symptoms or physical signs of being on too little? So it's more of the art of medicine when it comes to that. I don't have a blood test that I can use to try to determine whether you're on too much or too little. One final thing I'll say about steroids and sort of introduce the next topic. In patients who take growth hormone for growth hormone deficiency, usually growth hormone will accelerate the metabolism of hydrocortisone so that dexamethasone is the better steroid in the setting of growth hormone deficiency treated with growth hormone in patients who have hypopituitarism and take steroids. So that's another reason we like to use dexamethasone in our practice, because we're strong advocates of growth hormone replacement. And we indeed are. I've treated probably now, I would guess, over 700 to 800 patients with growth hormone deficiency throughout my career since growth hormone became available about 1998, maybe a little bit sooner. And then I did research studies before it was available, and I'm a strong advocate for growth hormone replacement. I've seen so many patients have such beneficial and remarkable changes in their quality of life with growth hormone. We do know that the if you look at the patient who has a history of pituitary disease of any type and has had, quote, normal, if you will, hormone levels, about 40% of them still have growth hormone deficiency. And you can look at the IGF-1 levels and find them either frankly low or in the low part of the normal range. But if you do a growth hormone stimulation test, you'll see that 40% of people with pituitary disease have growth hormone deficiency. The more hormone deficiencies you have, the greater the likelihood that you actually have growth hormone deficiency. Symptoms and signs often include things as mundane as weight gain, decreased fatigue, decreased energy, poor exercise capacity. And patients often would come in and say, I just don't feel right. I know you like where my hormone levels are, but I don't feel 100%. I don't feel like I expected that I would feel. And that's usually a person who has growth hormone deficiency, and they tend to gain weight over time. the symptoms and signs of growth hormone deficiency aren't always present. So the person who has normal growth hormone levels today but has a pituitary operation tomorrow, 6 weeks from now, might have growth hormone deficiency and otherwise normal pituitary function, and they'll feel fine. But 6 months to a year later, they will be languishing with fatigue and loss of muscle mass and increase in fat mass, and they find that they can't exercise any longer, and they tend to have less interest in social activities, etc. So some patients have a new diagnosis of growth hormone deficiency. Others have a diagnosis that's been there for a while and have all the symptoms and signs. And growth hormone replacement abolishes all of those things and improves the cardiovascular risk profile and improves the bone density and improves cognitive function, such that the brain fog that people often have improves as well. The goal of growth hormone replacement is to find an IGF-1 level that feels right for the patient. So when a patient feels much better and their fatigue is resolved and they can exercise and they start losing weight, we know that their IGF-1 is probably more appropriate. I tend to aim for an IGF-1 in the middle of the normal range, maybe slightly above the upper half of normal, and sometimes we'll push it a little bit towards the higher end of the normal range if the patient has no symptoms of being on too much growth hormone. But I certainly don't like to have them too much in the lower part of the normal range unless the patient gets symptoms such as joint aches or complaints or swelling in the hands or feet when we start treatment. My own personal belief is that if we restore IGF-1 and growth hormone levels to normal, there are no side effects of treatment. There's been no study that suggests that we cause pituitary tumors to grow or that we cause cancers to develop. I have seen several patients who've had cancer diagnoses after they've been on growth hormone. And I had one patient who was almost certain that her thyroid cancer sort of accelerated its growth after we started growth hormone replacement. But that doesn't mean that the growth hormone caused those cancers. It maybe just unmasks them. I think it's important, therefore, to just keep the IGF-1 level in the normal range. But we certainly don't go whacking out the pituitary in people who have cancer to get rid of growth hormone, so I don't feel that taking growth hormone if you have a cancer that's been controlled is a problem. The FDA has a limit on it and says that we can't use growth hormone in people with what they call active malignancy. So if you're undergoing chemotherapy for breast cancer or treatment for lung cancer or something like that, you probably should be off growth hormone until you're rendered disease-free from that cancer. But generally speaking, growth hormone replacement doesn't cause cancers, in my opinion. So we tend to treat patients and give them time off if they have cancer, but get them started back on it when they've been pronounced disease-free. Growth hormone sort of reminds me, growth hormone therapy is probably not indicated in patients who are sick and have to go to the ICU. So if that ever happens, your physician should stop your growth hormone while you're in the intensive care unit. And that recommendation comes from studies that where they tried to use growth hormone to improve people's outcomes in the ICU and found that they had worsened outcomes in response to being on growth hormone for a lot of different reasons. Some of it was the growth hormone dose was too high and patients developed diabetes. But the bottom line is that the indication for growth hormone is to stop it when you're going to the ICU for whatever reason. I'm often asked, and one of the questions I was going to address is, what about physicians who don't believe in growth hormone? And there are a lot of endocrinologists who tend to not believe in it. And many endocrinologists will tell you that it's still a research treatment. And that's simply not true. It was approved by the FDA, I think, in 1998, and it's been used since. And I think that physicians who tend to not use it or believe it are basically copping out, saying that because they don't want to go through the process of having to fill out forms and do the paperwork and do the authorizations, etc. And they probably weren't trained to use it and weren't familiar with it, so they invent this reason that it's research to not use it. So if you find an endocrinologist who's telling you that, you probably need to see a different endocrinologist, because I think that in modern era, most pituitary endocrinologists for certain are using growth hormone, and most of us believe that it is appropriate for a majority of our particular patients. I don't have all my patients with growth hormone deficiency on growth hormone replacement, but a majority of patients are. If I can't find a good reason to use it, or if someone doesn't want to use it, I'm happy to follow them and not treat them and just ensure that they stay healthy and use it as it becomes necessary to use it. Other hormones made up of the pituitary gland, I've often asked about replacing oxytocin or MSH or some of the endorphins, those aren't seemingly necessary in our particular patients. Oxytocin is a really interesting neurochemical or neurotransmitter that seems to promote bonding and sexual activity and may have something to do with libido. And whether it will be studied in the future and used for those purposes, who knows. It's related to DDAVP, which we obviously use in patients who have diabetes insipidus, either due to surgery or some other disease process affecting their posterior pituitary gland. And DDAVP therapy, I can talk for hours on the replacement of that. But just in general, if you're taking DDAVP, your physician might have started with a prescription for you, and some patients do very well following that prescription. But my goal is to ultimately teach patients to manage their diabetes insipidus on their own, depending on their activity, their response to the medication, their usual patterns of water intake, and the amount of polyuria that they're willing to tolerate. The most important thing about DDAVP therapy is to not get overtreated, because if you do, your sodium falls and you can get acute cerebral edema, which can be life-threatening and lead to death, obviously, if not disability. So I think it's important to avoid over-treatment with DDAVP, and I usually instruct my patients to give themselves time several times a week, if not daily, where they can tell the medication has run out of their system and been metabolized, and they have an increased thirst and an increased need to drink and excessive urination. And that sort of acts as a pop-off valve, if you will, and ensures that they're not over-treated. It might be inconvenient, but if that happens at a time when you're home watching TV or doing other things, that's okay. So the usual person, I'll start on the DDAVP at bedtime, usually the spray or tablets, and then have them use subsequent doses as necessary. I don't want there to be that period where they have excessive urination, if not daily, at least several times a week, to avoid over-treatment because of the dangers of hyponatremia. I think the other most important thing I can say about vasopressin therapy, and maybe even save a life or two today, is that you have to avoid excessive consumption of water when you're on vasopressin. And it's okay to drink in response to thirst, because thirst is your body telling you that you don't have enough water in your extracellular fluid and in your bloodstream. That's the way the system works, provided you have an attack thirst mechanism. But where I have seen people get into trouble is when they get the flu and their doctor says, drink plenty of fluids. And you know, that's okay for a normal person, because if I drink plenty of fluids to stay hydrated and drink too much, I'm going to pee that out. But if you take vasopressin and you drink plenty of fluids, you're going to hold on to that water. That's going to dilute out your serum sodium and lead to the cerebral edema or the brain swelling or water in the brain that can be very dangerous. So that's one situation where people with diabetes insipidus get into trouble. Another one is young people who go to fraternity parties or sorority parties or keg parties and drink a lot of fluid, a lot of beer or alcoholic beverages through that. Those are all water, and that water stays in your system. Another one is I've seen women get into trouble when they figure they want to lose weight, so they go on these diets where they have to drink large amounts of water. 8 to 12 glasses a day. So when you do that, if you have diabetes insipidus, guess what? You're going to hold on to that water. The normal person is going to pee it out. But if you have diabetes insipidus and a fixed dose of vasopressin, you're going to hold on to that water. So that's the dangerous situation. So just keep in mind where those dangers are. Learn to manage your DDAVP when it's hot outside and if you're exercising outside, and figure out how much water you need and how much vasopressin you need. And it may be that on occasion you have to call your doctor and say, hey, look, you know, I drank a lot of fluid on a hike. I need to come straight to the ER, straight to the clinic, and get a sodium level check just so that I know that I'm safe to manage it this way. And sometimes that's a useful thing in a patient learning to manage his or her diabetes insipidus, is to grab a few sodiums after situations that were not typical for a daily experience, so that you know for the future that you might have to make an alteration. So we support our patients who want to do that anytime, and work with your physician so that you can learn to do that and you can learn to manage your vasopressin. There are really no symptoms or signs of being on too much. If it's mildly too much, patients tend to sort of realize that their disease is well controlled, and before you know it, their sodium level has drifted low and they have no symptoms or signs and their brain's gotten used to that vasopressin being too much. And the big risk for those patients who are on chronically too much is stopping their vasopressin, because then when you start to pee, your sodium level goes up too fast, and that's not healthy for the brain either. So I think it's important to avoid being overtreated, so that if you are overtreated and it's mildly so and there are no symptoms of it, the worst thing that can happen is suddenly being without your medication with the vasopressin, because then your sodium goes too fast and the brain doesn't do well with that, and that can lead to chronic neurologic disability as well. So this diabetes insipidus thing is where the Goldilocks thing is probably in pituitary disease the most critical, because of the effect of water on the brain. So I tend to find that to be the area that it's interesting. The paradox is patients we like to put in control of it, but it's also the most dangerous disorder to have if you have a pituitary problem. And I urge you to work with your physicians and learn as much as you can about management of your diabetes insipidus if that's the problem that you have, because you want to avoid overtreatment, because if you come off your medicine or don't have access to it or can't get to the pharmacy when you've been overtreated, you're probably at greatest risk for neurological disability there, as you are if you drink too much fluid excessively when you don't really need to be drinking that fluid. So keep those things in mind. Now, there are a number of treatments for patients who have Cushing's and acromegaly and prolactinomas. I want to touch on those topics briefly and then probably leave the last 15 minutes or so for questions. I think I've answered most of the questions that came to me, but some of them will come up as well. So in regards to Cushing syndrome, it used to be that for medical management of patients who have residual disease, we had a number of different drugs to treat them. Now we have two main drugs. One is ketoconazole that blocks the cortisol production rates in the adrenal glands. And ketoconazole is a drug that I think is on the hit list and probably will ultimately one day not be available for long. And that's because we've known since it came out that in Cushing's 15% of patients will have liver injury, but it's gotten the attention of the FDA and there's now a black box warning, and I heard some rumors that the company that makes the drug might not continue to make that for too long. We'll have to wait and see what happens, but it's been the workhorse for patients who have Cushing's and still have it after surgery while we're waiting for radiation to work, and we're not sure what's going to happen with that, but it's still my favorite drug for patients who have mild Cushing's after surgery and may need it. There's a new drug, Signifor, that's produced by one of the drug companies that actually works against the ACTH-producing pituitary tumors to lower ACTH and thus lower cortisol. It works in about a quarter of patients. We have some success using it and familiarity using it and find it to be a reasonable drug. It's very expensive, and it can cause diabetes and a couple other things, and those are some of the problems with the drug. But generally speaking, it's useful to try that in patients who have significant residual Cushing's after surgery. This is a drug we're going to learn more about over the next few years. It's only been out for about a year now or so, and we'll get more familiarity with that. We may be forced to learn more about it if ketoconazole comes off the market. And then we're going to be, I think, finding a lot of people probably will be going to adrenalectomy to best control their Cushing's and then having radiation to control their pituitary tumor. So Cushing's is in sort of a state of evolution. We now have mifepristone also, I should mention, which can be used to treat the symptoms of Cushing's. That I think is probably a good drug for patients who have severe symptomatic Cushing's and can get some improvement there while they're waiting for other therapies to work as well. There are a lot of different drugs to treat acromegaly, drugs that block the somatostatin receptors and drugs that block the growth hormone receptors, and then dopamine agonist drugs as well. They all have their own individual little side effects, and their efficacies are different, and that's really beyond the topic here. But our goals in acromegaly are to sort of normalize the IGF-1 and to do that with a drug that's convenient for the patient and has little to no side effects in the particular patient. I don't have really a preference for one drug over the other. The somatostatin analogs I use in some patients, the growth hormone receptor blocker, somivert, I use in other patients. Dopamine agonist drugs like cabergoline I use in some patients, just depends on the situation. It's sort of an area where there have been a lot of different flow diagrams and flow charts and algorithms and recommendations from different groups on how to manage patients, but I have learned through my clinical practice that you have to individualize care, and I treat patients as individuals, and I don't treat them according to flow diagrams because everybody's different, and one drug might work for somebody, but it's not going to work for another patient based on their lifestyle or their side effect profile or their willingness to do a certain treatment. So I introduce I might sort of come across and tell a patient, I think this is the best drug for you, but I'll introduce all those particular drugs for that particular patient, and I tend not to follow flow charts to treat patients. I think that's wholly inappropriate, and I get tired of seeing these publications that are telling physicians how to use these particular drugs and what order to use them. I think it's just totally inappropriate, and looks at acromegalic patients as a population and not as individuals. And again, I like to individualize therapy because I can have 100 people with acromegaly, and that's the same disease, but it's 100 totally different illnesses because the illness is not only how it affects that particular person and how their tissues are sensitive to growth hormone and IGF-1, but it's how it affects their spouse, their children, their work environment, their livelihood, their recreation, and their psyche as well, and therefore they have to be treated as individuals because it's 100 different illnesses, even though it's the same disease in this particular patient. And all the tumors are different anyway, so everybody needs a little bit something different, whether it be surgery and or radiation or surgery and medication, for example. So make sure your doctor treats you as an individual and isn't going on some sort of a flow diagram that was written in some journal, because that's not the appropriate way to practice medicine in my mind. When it comes to the prolactinomas, we have two drugs, cabergoline and bromocriptine, and generally speaking, prolactinomas should have the prolactin level normalized so that fertility is restored or sex hormones are normalized, and the prolactin should be normalized to try to sort of limit tumor growth. With that said, it's not always possible to normalize the prolactin, and I have several patients on maximum dose of cabergoline, for example, whose prolactin levels were 10,000 and are now 100, and even though 100's too high, their tumors have regressed, and I'm comfortable watching them with high levels because I can't do anything else to get them down. Their tumors might be invasive, and we can't sort of get all the tumor out, so we continue to treat them with medication therapy to achieve the lowest prolactin that we can and make sure the tumor is not growing over time. And if they have other hormone deficits or sex steroid deficits, we treat those as well. Usually treating the prolactin normalizes the sex steroids in about 90% of patients who are reproductive age, but it doesn't always work. And some of those patients need other treatments as well. TSH-producing tumors, the somatostatin analogs tend to work on those. Those are rare, but some people have them and have hyperthyroidism, and the somatostatin analogs work in 95% of the patients. I think that pretty much covers what I wanted to cover. I may have hit the highlights of some of these questions that I had. Let me just make sure. So, so there's a question about vitamins and supplements and things of that nature, and you know, I believe in good health, and I think that people should do what they need to do to stay healthy. It's probably known that most adults don't get enough vitamin D and calcium, so you should think about that. And I think that after age 45, most people, even though I don't, should take a multivitamin to try to stay healthy. I have patients who do juicing and patients who do different extracts of mushrooms and things of that nature. I think it's okay to try those things as long as you're doing things and do the research and make sure that you're not doing something that's unsafe. There have been reports throughout time that where people do things, you know, for example, some herbal teas or some mushrooms can cause liver injury. So just if you're going to do things like that, just be careful. Do your research and study that. There's nothing wrong with taking vitamins and things of that nature, but there's not anything that we know that you can do that's going to either prevent your pituitary tumor or shrink your pituitary tumor or make your hormones work better, for example. But I think it's good to just practice good health, have a healthy diet, try to live an active lifestyle. Even walking is tremendous exercise if you do it. And then take a multivitamin and ensure you get your calcium and your vitamin D. I don't subscribe to a lot of the panaceas that are out there, and you know, patients come in and bring bottles of things where they're spending hundreds of dollars a month on stuff that I don't even know what's in it. And I read the labels and I still don't understand it and know what's in it. And I'm not sure that's any better than the cure-alls and panaceas that were sort of touted in the 1800s. So be careful about how you spend your money and do your research. As a physician, I usually tell patients I don't have an opinion on those topics, but I sort of illustrate to them that those things aren't FDA approved, and sometimes getting too much of what seems to be a good thing can be a bad thing in the long run. Let me see another question here. So there's a question about slow-release hydrocortisone, and there are studies that are going on in Europe and maybe even in this country as well about extended or slow-release hydrocortisone. I have no experience with that whatsoever, but that's something that might potentially be of use to us in the future. It's basically a tablet that releases hydrocortisone. It goes as it goes through the intestinal tract. So to me, the release is going to be dependent on the intestinal transit time, which can be affected by what you eat. So I'm not sure that it's going to be any more reliable than the current hydrocortisone that we have. And we also don't know what the effect of hydrocortisone is and what the half-life is inside the nucleus of the cell. But I tend to favor dexamethasone, and even if the slow-release hydrocortisone is approved, I would probably also use the dexamethasone over the slow-release hydrocortisone. So why don't we go, I think we've got about 12 to 15 minutes. Why don't we go to some questions? I don't see any in the chat box. Tammy, do you have any questions that you can pass on to me?
Yes, we have several, actually. The first okay. one, my
pituitary. You can read them.
Yes, I will. My pituitary gland was ablated in 1978 as treatment for diabetic retinopathy. I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at age of 12 and a half months. Since 1978, I've taken synthetic thyroid and hydrocortisone. Until I was about 50, I took synthetic estrogen and progesterone. After I stopped those two hormones, I was diagnosed with osteopenia. I now take generic Beneva. In the mid-1980s, I started taking fludrocortisone because I was having bad dizzy spells. That helped for several years, but for the past few years, I've been having bad dizziness again. Different doctors have suggested different causes, but none seem to fit. For example, diabetes neuropathy. But I have spells when I'm lying down, so it's not because my nerves aren't working adequately to get blood up to my brain when I stand up. I also take simvastatin and spironolactone. I was having trouble with dizziness long before I started on those last two medications. Is my dizziness due to the lack of a pituitary gland and resulting hormone replacement?
That's a fascinating story, and you know, it's interesting that people used to get pituitary ablations for metastatic cancer and diabetic retinopathy, and the goal in diabetic retinopathy was to try to lower growth hormone levels. So we don't see that too much any longer. The hormone replacements that you're on seem to be pretty appropriate. I'm curious, though, that they have you on the fludrocortisone, which is often used in people who have diabetic retinopathy, and your own spironolactone, and those two drugs are sort of antagonizing one another, and they may have the balance of that off of leading to the dizziness. There are a number of causes of dizziness, and diabetic autonomic neuropathy is probably the most common thing. If you had retinopathy in the 70s, you probably do have autonomic neuropathy, so you may have some heart rate problems where the heart doesn't really have an appropriate, you may have lost the variability of your heart rate and didn't have appropriate controls that can lead to the dizziness. The dizziness laying down can be due to a number of different things, and I would suggest a careful evaluation by a neurologist to try to find the cause. It's probably not related to the pituitary disorder, but I wonder about the use of the fludrocortisone and the spironolactone together and whether you really truly have a diabetic autonomic neuropathy leading to that dizziness. The irony is that you're now on growth hormone, which they were trying to eradicate when you had the retinopathy. So that's the most curious thing. We now know that the retinopathy is not to be treated by eradicating the pituitary, so at least they're giving you the growth hormone back, because I think that's an essential treatment. On the other hand, you have to make sure the growth hormone dose is not too high and worsening the diabetes to begin with.
Okay,
so
thank you.
How about the next question?
The next question is, could the doctor address cramping? Despite high dose calcium and magnesium, I suffer from cramping all over my body, feet, legs, ribs, back. No one seems to be able to explain why I cramp this way.
Okay, so interestingly, that's a good follow-up question, because one of the common things that patients with diabetes and neuropathy have is cramping, so it could potentially be related to that. And there are lots of different neuropathies, like a vitamin B12 deficiency can lead to a neuropathy, and some of those patients can have cramping. Pituitary patients with cramping can be those with Cushing's who have low potassiums and low magnesiums. Patients who are hypothyroid and on too little thyroid hormone can also have cramping. So those are the main things that I would think about related to my specialty. A lot of people as they get older, though, have cramping, and quinine used to be a common treatment for that particular type of cramping, but it's worth considering that it might just be cramping with age as well. I don't know the age of the person who asked the question, but something also to consider that could be age-related. But with regards to pituitary disease, it's low potassium and Cushing's, too little thyroid hormone. Those are the more common things that we'll see that cause cramping. And then if you have hypoparathyroidism or low calcium levels, that can lead to muscle cramping as well. It's an endocrine disorder, but not related to pituitary disease at this time.
Okay, next question. What test would show a need for oxytocin? My son is on DDAVP, levothyroxine, hydrocortisone, and testosterone. He opted out of continuing GH. I've never heard about oxytocin, so just wondering.
Yeah, there's unfortunately no test to determine whether we need oxytocin. It's made in the hypothalamus and sometimes secreted in the circulation. Probably there are other neural pathways that secrete it in the brain, and then we presume it's also in the posterior pituitary, but we don't really have a role for it in hypopituitary patients. Like I mentioned earlier, it might be a hormone that's very important in bonding and love relationships, but we don't have a treatment that we can use to determine whether or not patients need it, and we don't really define who would need it either.
Okay, next question. What is your experience with radiation therapy levels to preserve pituitary function? I was treated with 54 gray for a non-resected craniopharyngioma and have experienced increasing levels of fatigue for 2 years.
Okay, that would seem to be an appropriate dose for conventional radiotherapy to treat that particular tumor, or even pituitary tumors that we used to treat with conventional radiotherapy and still do sometimes. And that usually is two-thirds to 80% of patients within 10 years will have one or more pituitary hormone deficits with that level of radiation. And it's not necessarily the pituitary gland that gets injured. Sometimes gamma knife radiosurgery is high enough dose to injure the pituitary gland. But usually what happens is the blood vessels between the pituitary and the hypothalamus are scarred down, or the hypothalamic cells are injured because of the radiation. And it's hard to determine what dose, some people have tried to look at that, it's hard to determine what dose is necessary to spare pituitary function. When you think about patients with craniopharyngiomas or pituitary tumors, there are other reasons for them to have hypopituitarism. It's possible these tumors are stealing blood from the normal pituitary, or they're pressing on the pituitary stalk and the hypothalamic hormones aren't getting down, or it could be the radiation itself causing the damage. What we do know, and what I see rather, and I think that some of the literature points out too, is that a person who has more interventions for their pituitary disease is more likely to end up with hormone deficits. So it's pretty hard to say, let's find a dose of radiation to try to save pituitary function, when it might be the tumor that's being treated that's compromising pituitary function in the first place. And then the other thing is we want to give enough radiation to treat the tumor. So most of the radiation therapies are based on how much radiation is necessary to treat the tumor. And we don't tend to worry about the hypopituitarism because we have reasonable treatments for such.
Okay, thank you. Next one, if one has trouble converting vitamin D3, is it likely that T4 has trouble converting to T3?
I don't understand how the vitamin D came into that question. Maybe it's related to what patients have trouble converting T4 to T3, and those are patients who are taking beta blockers. mostly. The beta blockers tend to impair that conversion. Sometimes if you're on too much steroid therapy for adrenal insufficiency, you can have trouble converting T4 to T3. And there is an extremely rare number of patients who have a genetic defect where they have trouble converting T4 to T3 as well. And then people have chronic illness. So if you have lupus or rheumatoid arthritis or chronic pneumonia or COPD, just the effects of illness can also lead to impaired conversion of T4 to T3. That's a standard. Seems to be a homeostatic response, but we don't fully understand it. But the big thing that I see is the patients on a beta blocker are on too much steroids and may have low T3 levels in that setting.
Okay, thank you. Another question, kind of similar question, but different person. If you have a THS-producing tumor, will it affect the lab results of TSH, T4, T3, or does it just produce the symptoms of hypothyroidism?
No, it affects the lab results. So the person with a TSH-producing tumor usually will have high T4 and T3 levels, and the TSH can be either normal or elevated. It's not always high because it's the TSH secreted in the period of time, or in a 24-hour period, if you will, that sort of makes a difference. All of our hormones are secreted in pulses, and there's a diurnal variation with those secretions, so that TSH is mostly secreted at night. It's also secreted during the daytime, but the pulses are usually at night. And when you have a tumor that secretes TSH, for example, or growth hormone or any of these other hormones, it's secreted erratically, but usually levels are either there. If you measure the secretion in a 24-hour period, the mass of hormone secreted is much greater than the mass would be in a normal pattern of secretion where you have pulses and areas between pulses where there's little to no hormone secretion, or what we call basal hormone secretion, so that the amount secreted in a 24-hour period is higher. So normally a person with a TSH-secreting tumor, even though they had a normal TSH, would have a high T4 and a T3 level in that setting. I just thought of one other thing based on the T3 thing to add, is that one other important thing to know about thyroid hormone is that if you're a woman and you take birth control pills or estrogens, you may require a higher dose of thyroid hormone. And if you stop your estrogens, you may require a lowering of the dose of thyroid hormone. The same thing is true of growth hormone. If you're a woman taking estrogens by mouth, you're going to require a higher dose of growth hormone. And if you ever stop your estrogens, your growth hormone dose is going to have to come down. And those things are important to keep in mind. Pregnant women, for example, need more thyroid hormone. Women taking birth control pills need more thyroid hormone. If you stop those, you need to lower the dose. And the same thing's true for the growth hormone. So just keep that in mind, too, as you interact. And the reason I bring that up is I've seen patients who have growth hormone replacement therapy and take estrogens, and then for whatever reason, maybe a fear of breast cancer or whatever, they stop their estrogens, and now their growth hormone dose is going to be too high. And then they come to the clinic 6 months later with swelling of their hands and looking a little acromegalic, and it's that they didn't lower the growth hormone when they stopped the estrogens. So keep that in mind, too.
Good information. Thank you.
Next question.
I have a non-secreting pituitary tumor. I'm on cabergoline. Do you think cabergoline is helpful for this type of tumor?
I do not. There was a study published when I was in my training that suggested that maybe 5% of non-functioning tumors respond to cabergoline. My own feeling is that those may be tumors that are prolactinomas that inefficiently produce prolactin. And maybe an acidophil stem cell adenoma, which is a type of a prolactinoma, for example, and they usually don't respond to cabergoline anyway. They usually require surgery. So I tend to not, and when I was in my training, it was one of the things that we could do, but we know so much more about pituitary disease now than we used to, and it was recommended that if you had a non-functioning tumor before you went to surgery, you should try cabergoline or bromocriptine to see if it shrinks the tumor. That is, in my opinion, a waste of time and a waste of money. And so few patients are going to respond. And even those who do have those low prolactin levels with prolactinomas who might respond to treatment, usually don't respond that well and ultimately go to surgery anyway. So I don't practice that brand of endocrinology any longer. I did that in my training and maybe for a few years after. But I found it to be fruitless, and I think that surgery is the best way to proceed, especially in my institution. We have the best surgeons in the world who can operate even on prolactinomas and usually cure people. But if I thought the patient had a non-functioning tumor, I would not try a dopamine agonist drug to try to regress it.
Okay, thank you. We're getting close to the end here. I want to ask one or two more questions. The first one is, I'm temporarily sexing doctors in a fellowship clinic. How do you suggest I broach things when both the fellow and the attending are unfamiliar with current standards in treating panhypopituitarism?
Well, if you have another option, find another doctor. If there's no other option, I think to sort of be polite and courteous and respectful and bring forth things that you've learned through your reading to them and ask for their consideration to give things a trial. If they brush you off, then you definitely need to find another physician.
Okay, I think this next one will be the last question. I had my first surgery in 1991 and the second in 2005. No tumor regrowth now. I'm on Synthroid and Androgel. I have all the symptoms Dr. Blevins describes for GH deficiency. My IGF-1 level has been in the 80 ng/ml range for years. I cannot find an endocrinologist that will treat me for GH deficiency. Any recommendations on how to approach a doctor or information I can use?
You know, again, it's a situation where some physicians aren't believers, so to speak. I think it's important to try to find a physician who you can partner with who will treat, or someone who's willing to learn to treat. My experience is probably 30 to 40% of endocrinologists might be interested in treating, but 60 to 70% are not. So it may be having to sort of make some phone calls and find out if the physician treats patients with growth hormone. If there's no one in the community, sometimes it's worth traveling to find a physician who will treat, and then contact the local physician before you travel and say, hey, if I can find someone who will treat me, will you monitor? And what I have learned is that some physicians who don't treat are willing to sort of continue to follow the patient and then monitor with us, and ultimately they sort of see the benefits of therapy and are willing to treat. This particular patient, I would be 95%, 99% certain that he has growth hormone deficiency. If he's already on two hormone replacements and has such a low normal IGF-1 level, I would expect the testing to be abnormal. And if there is a history of pituitary disease, that growth hormone replacement would be required, and I suspect the patient would have dramatic benefit in response to treatment. So I think it's worth pursuing and trying to find a physician who can take care of that.
Excellent. Okay, thank you. And actually, I see one more question that I want to pose to you. Okay. What is the number one thing I can do to manage my hypopituitarism?
The number one thing, take your pills or your injections, and work with your physician to ensure that the doses are optimized, because again, therapy has to be optimal. Simply having a normal T4 might not be enough, or simply having a normal IGF-1 might not be enough. It needs to be optimized for you as an individual. So take the medication, sort of a two-part answer. Take the medications and ensure your therapy is optimized. And I guess if I were going to add a third part, or part C to the one answer, would be informed. You know, understand your medications and understand their importance.
Excellent. Okay, thank you. Dr. Blevins, we appreciate you doing this webinar for us. Really like this format. I think it worked well. Look forward to everybody's responses to our survey after the fact. See if you enjoyed it as much as we did.
I did. You know, it's sort of different. It's the first time I've done anything like this, but I just thought it might be more useful than showing a bunch of slides and, you know, just talking more freely. Sometimes I think I'm going to be more prompted to sort of get things out of my head that I would otherwise not be if I were constrained to a set of slides. So I hope it's been informative and useful to those out there who are listening. So thanks for listening in, and good health to you all, and be your best advocates. Find physicians who will work with you. Be kind to your doctors. We work hard, and it's tough. You know, we see 18 or 20 patients with pituitary disease in a day. That can wear us out sometimes, so be easy on us. Recognize that we're here to help you, and we want to see the best health possible. And if your physician doesn't have that attitude, it's time to find another doctor. So good luck, and let us know how we can be of help. All right, thank you.
Excellent information, Dr. Blevins. Thank you very much. This concludes our webinar.
Day,
you too. Thank you.